Good evening. We have a full crowd. It's really wonderful to have everyone here. Welcome to the February 22nd, 2017 Board of Selectmen, Board of Health meeting. We are starting the meeting at 6:33. First item on the agenda, we have minutes of January 11th and February 8th.
They were right behind.
Oh, yes. Yeah, I got both of them.
In order. Everything's in order.
Make a motion to accept January 11th.
I'll second the motion.
Okay. All those in favor?
Yeah, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Oh, wait. Was there a second? You seconded it, right?
I seconded. Yep.
Okay. Do you make a motion for February 8th?
I was not here, can I?
Never mind.
I make a motion that we accept the minutes of February 8th.
And I'll second. If there's no further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Abstain.
And one abstention. Perfect. I forgot you weren't here.
Yeah.
Thank you. You were having a really good week
in
Florida while we were having a stinky week. It was really messy. Anyway, okay. Next item on the agenda is Selectman's comments. Just real quickly, I had a wonderful Homeland Security meeting yesterday. There is this huge FEMA mobilization exercise. It's a multi-million-dollar exercise. October 19th to the 23rd of 2017. And I am hoping that both of you will be as enthusiastic as I have, because
sure.
I went out on the limb and volunteered us already. This
All right.
is going to be about 150 to 200 people involved.
Okay.
And this is from Thursday, the October 19th through Sunday. So it will cost us a little bit of money in the sense that we're going to have to pay probably some overtime or extra policing if we get the police involved and everything. But what this is so exciting, because these are this is one of those huge exercises that comes to the region only every few years, like every decade.
Yep.
And the scenario is Hurricane Irene kind of scenario.
Right.
And they're going to do it, massive bridge and road damage, loss of power, vehicle access issues. Mass task force is going to be in, deployed to Western Mass. They're going to have dive team that wants to dive on a bridge. So
right.
I thought, oh my God, they can dive on Stillwater Bridge and
yep.
tell us what's happening with the state job and give
How's
us an independent assessment.
Right.
I was so excited because EPA is going to be here.
Nice.
We were within inches of being inundated in Irene at our sewer treatment plant. And as you know, the Green River did inundate Greenfield's plant. So they are going to assume that we have a sewer plant failure at Old Deerfield. So
right.
they will activate that plan and what we have to do. They're going to have Homeland Security has this new mobile DNA testing, rapid DNA testing thing. And I thought, oh my gosh, this is great for our police to practice with that. The EMS, they want to actually transport people, usually in these scenarios, in a much smaller scale, cheaper exercise. They just take the, you know, the victim to a spot and then, you know, then they're done. But they're actually going to go through all the way and transporting to the hospital and use the hospital as a, you know, surge capacity and open that up for, you know, like an extra wing
Great.
For mass casualty.
Yeah.
I talked to Marlene at the senior center. She's willing to work with the seniors, and we can talk about evacuating our senior vulnerable population that can't necessarily get out, that you
right.
know, maybe not be able to drive. I mean, we have a whole list of those people.
Yeah.
And so that we can actually have that scenario. And one of the things that I've been really concerned about, because since Irene, you know, part of the Irene issue was the releases from TransCanada and Bear Swamp were at the same time. So we have worked so hard to make sure that they talk to each other and that they talk to us, so that if their releases are imminent, that they don't do it at the same time. And with the sale of TransCanada, you know, I can call Calgary EOC right now and talk to someone, and they'll give us updates. They call me at my home. You know, I mean, there's a huge relationship now. If they get sold, you know, are they not wanting to work with us, and that relationship goes down the pot, and we got to start all over again. So part of this scenario is going to mean that TransCanada or whoever owns them and Bear Swamp will have a plan instead of just this informal agreement.
Yeah.
That I can call them and complain to them. They will actually have a plan where they will commit to calling our EOCs and letting us know and coordinating with each other.
Perfect.
Also, because of Irene, we have, you know, our riparian buffers and our banks are in some places 16 feet less than they were before Irene. So our inundation maps are incorrect. And part of the relicensing, TransCanada is supposed to be doing new inundation maps for us, but to date, they have not done that. So part of this exercise is that TransCanada is, they'll do the inundation maps for a release or a dam failure, but also mm-hmm. for just our different rainfalls. So we will have new inundation maps will show us all the vulnerable areas and how much coverage, like on 5 and 10 and Mill Village and
how much will be underwater.
And Main Street here. And I mean, they're going to do all new mapping for us. So
that's great.
Hugely
that's a huge
exciting
yeah.
thing.
Yeah.
It's been very, you know, the last couple of years we've been fighting on the pipeline. And so we haven't had the flu vaccination donation that we normally get from the DPH. So we haven't done our EDS drills. So even though our volunteer list, people have been so wonderful about updating us and changing their phones if their numbers change or whatever, we haven't really done any emergency drills. So I'm so excited about this because mm-hmm. we can update our emergency medical volunteers as well as our just regular volunteers. And then we haven't really done anything with our Deerfield operation neighborhood, which is Dawn,
yeah.
which is how after 2005 flooding, we had split up the town into sections. So if they got split off from each other, one or two people would call. But once we got code red, we sort of let that go. So, but, you know, with the avian flu kind of risk out there and all these, you know, terrible flooding still could happen, it would be really nice if we, activated that again and got that. Mm-hmm. Use the energy.
Good practice.
And it would be wicked good practice,
practice
for you guys to get onto this emergency preparedness stuff.
Okay. I'm with you.
So we went from the flood to the bird flu to chaos.
Yeah, but this is...
You never know what's going to hit.
But this yep. is but this is an opportunity because they're sending hazmat people. They're sending... I mean, every
it's
single...
It's a big expense.
Oh, man, it's multi-million dollar. And they're using us.
That's
I mean,
great.
So anyway, I volunteered... us, and it just happened John Pachorik was there at the Homeland Security meeting because he's the Western Mass Police Rep.
Yep.
And so he agreed to do this. I haven't talked to Kevin, but I think it would just be a wonderful way for us, for very little money, to get everybody energized again about preparedness. We can talk to Father Randy. He had worked with the interfaith group, and mm-hmm. and we could practice sheltering because... yes, in an emergency, we're going to open up something. But
can you talk closer to the mic?
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, I'm sorry. It gives us the opportunity to practice sheltering because there is a huge responsibility in sheltering. Obviously, if we have an event and we need to open a shelter, we'll open a shelter. But it's, you have to do SORI and CORI checks with people. And I don't know if you remember Snowtober back in 2011, but one of my friends was in charge of the Northampton shelter, and they had snakes and reptiles and everything just coming into their shelter because people lost electricity and they couldn't keep those creatures warm. And I'm terrible with snakes. I just have to say that. Snakes on the plane, just the ad was enough to drive me crazy. So, I mean, there is serious issues with sheltering. So we have a shelter plan. We should at least practice it.
Sounds good.
So I hope you guys are okay with that.
I'm with you.
Well, okay.
We can't turn down snakes?
No, you can't. Seriously. If someone comes in here and says that I'm anxious and this is my... How I feel comfortable.
What if there's a person next to who was anxious about this?
Well, I'm anxious, let me tell you. So
right.
It doesn't matter. By law, you can't turn them away, Kip. This okay. is why I say it's a little bit complicated. It's
right.
not a straightforward thing.
Okay.
All right. Sounds good.
So you're okay?
I'm with you.
Okay.
Let's go.
All right. Was there any questions on that?
Not yet.
We will practice sheltering, but if you have a snake, please don't come. Anyway, I guess the Board of Health comments.
That was it.
Yep.
No, well, that was part of Board of Health, but we had a mosquito meeting today, and that was...
They're not back yet, are they?
No, no. We're still trying...
The snakes can eat them.
Not quick enough.
So, Trevor, so just that I don't talk, you want to talk about the mosquito meeting?
Yeah, we had a good meeting today, and we're gathering all the information, working with, I think we're up to 9 towns right now looking
well, we
to
have,
get involved.
We
have four.
We have four others, but...
Four others.
But plus a 9, yeah.
That are looking to get together. Go ahead.
She sucked you into the mosquito meetings now?
Oh, I've been there.
Oh, jeez.
All along.
Me too.
Yep.
And Wendy.
You're outnumbered,
today
kid.
By phone.
no, it's very interesting to see where, you know, all that's being planned and all that goes behind trying to get testing to find out what we have in our area and all up and down the valley. So we're coordinating putting together a Pioneer Valley Mosquito District, which is a lot of work on a lot of different state agencies and local towns coming together and Board of Health to try and get testing to see what we have in our area. For species, what carries disease, with climate change happening and more things, you know, getting warmer, a lot wetter, we're going to see a lot more change. Obviously, last year was pretty dry, so we didn't have much to find out for info, but we have gotten some information back, and we'll see what this year brings. And
I think what was scary is the traps for the mosquitoes, the Zika. Potentially can carry Zika. Our Windsor Locks is the most northern that was monitored. The problem is we don't really have any monitoring north of that. But if you look at the climate of Windsor Locks, it's actually warmer in Springfield. So if they can winter over in Windsor Locks, then they can winter over in Springfield. And Springfield has a huge amount of old drainage, underground drainage that has light exposure, so it harbors an awful lot of stuff that carries over. So it is a serious thing. So we're focusing on identifying habitat and surveillance and how to do it in a sustainable, least expensive way that's meaningful so that if we get a hit, and they're in a hit of a disease-carrying mosquito, not just a nuisance mosquito, it's about 50 species of mosquitoes that are in our area, and the nuisance ones, you know, we're not bothering to do anything about, but the disease-carrying ones is the ones we want to monitor, and we'd be able to do a spraying of a bio larvicide kind of thing, not a chemical spray. Early intervention that would be effective and the least expensive way to deal with them. Mm-hmm. So that's basically what we're trying to do. And believe it or not, you know, it's starting to come together, and I'm really excited about that.
Yeah. Good work.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is Town Administrator's Report.
I would like to say we have a number of people here who are scheduled to do things, mm-hmm. and I neglected one, so we've got a lot on the plate.
Okay.
We're going to talk about budgets later, and I'll give a report then.
Sounds good.
Okay. Sounds
perfect.
Great. We have next item on the agenda then is... the library trustees, they would like to appoint a trustee to the vacant position. Would you like to come up?
Hello. How are you?
Good evening.
Good evening.
You're not a trustee, but you're an important part of the library.
That's right.
Good evening. I'm Nancy Maynard, Chairman of the Trustees, and we have Sarah Woodbury, our librarian, Cindy Van Fladern, our secretary, and Kathy O'Rourke as the trustee. And so we're here tonight looking to hold a joint meeting to fill our vacant position that we have open, and Marjorie Shearer, who is a longtime library user, has expressed interest in that position, and the Board of Trustees voted during the month of February that we would like to come forth and make that nomination, and we need your support of doing that.
Great.
Is Wendy, is it a joint vote, or is it a vote that we do separately?
No, you
can vote.
We talked, Sarah and I talked about that. So it's nice of you to come.
Yes.
I was hoping one of you would be Marjorie. The mystery. Okay, so you probably won't. But yeah, we've clarified the statutory, but it's not. It's a...
So it is our, so
yes. I think it's a joint meeting.
Joint meeting.
And so that then...
No,
and
no, okay. It doesn't it's have
no?
to be.
No, no. Okay.
It's a recommendation.
It's a recommendation from you, and they make
to
the
you.
Okay, sorry.
Okay.
Can I make a motion? Could I make a motion to appoint Marjorie Shearer to the to a trustee of the Tilton Library?
Great. I'll second the motion.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you so much. I'm sorry to make you come all that way tonight.
That's right.
2 minutes.
Exciting.
But do you have any quick update for us?
I just wanted to give a quick plug for the program that's going to be at the library this Saturday. It's for train enthusiasts of all ages. It's a toy train talk and display at 2 o'clock. And it's sponsored by a grant from the local cultural council, which is part of the Massachusetts Cultural Council, a state agency. So everyone's welcome. It's free. And we're looking forward to a talk by Barry Dietz. He was here last year talking about Highway 91. He's going to talk about Robert Frost as part of our 100th anniversary celebration. And that will be here in this room on March 29th. So
March 29th? That's great.
I'm so sorry. So.
And oh, also, we wanted to say thank you to the highway crew for their excellent work in getting us back connected with the sewer line. So that was
I know,
really
I heard
good.
There was a huge disaster.
But it's been, temporary.
So it's all good.
Good.
Okay.
Good.
So the one other update is we have our annual wine and cheese microbrew that's going to be happening at Chandler's on March 9th from 6 to 8 p.m. And tickets are $20 prior to the event, $25 at the door. So we hope that people will come and support the library and enjoy some of our local brews.
Great.
Great.
Good. Exciting.
All right.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Great. Thank you guys for coming.
Thank you.
Paul, do you want to come up?
Oh, thank you.
Yes, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Great.
The last lady again. Yes,
okay.
Hello, Paul.
Hey there.
Paul,
so,
thank you for coming.
Thank you for, this came about, we had our February 9th meeting, and the board suggested, our counsel, Felicity Hardy, suggested I and Wendy weighed in that it would probably be appropriate to make a formal presentation of basically 2 years of work coming to fruition.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, it's essentially about 2 years since we started this whole thing. Actually, I got from Casey the grant application to get the money from so we could get the COG to do this. Yep. So, long story short, the legislation, you have it in front of you, the bill, I believe.
Everything's in order.
Yeah.
Okay.
You should see the a copy of the bill that was presented to the legislature about July or August. I think it got into the meat grinder down in on Beacon Hill around then. I think it was filed on August 10th. Bill number 4596. Long story short, this is the bill that would, based on our economic development plan, grant certain authorities, which including adding the commercial aspect, which an edict back in the day was formed for manufacturing and industrial.
Right.
And I know, Wendy, correct me if I'm right, that we're one of the very few edicts in this state.
You were the first in the whole state.
We are the...
Deerfield was the first edict in the state.
In the state, back in the mid-70s when Jack Cheslin, Chick, and Helen, and all those guys saved Miller's Falls Tool from leaving the area.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the old plan needed updating when we revived, got edict back on its feet. So the long story short, the work of the board, DEDIC board, our counsel, Felicity Hardy, and the great work of both Senator Stanley Rosenberg and also Steve Kulik's office, who basically, we had some days because this went to the governor's desk, as you can see, but there's a a timeline, maybe not on what you have in front of you, but the bottom line is the governor, his excellency, Charlie Baker, had until January 13th to sign this bill. And otherwise, if he did not, it was called the pocket veto, and it would fall off the desk, and we'd have to be starting this whole thing. And really, thanks to Stan and Steve's office and a number of folks, you know, as part of their staff, got this thing signed. And we did get confirmation on the 13th that it's signed. So we are now legal in Great. What we can do. I mean, is there commercial development in the park? Yeah. But are you going to look past employment and taxes? No. Right. But now we have the ability, we don't have to worry about, you know, any kind of conflict Thank or you. Any kind of issue.
Yep.
So I wanted, you know, we thought the board, Wendy and all of us, that it would probably be best to formally recognize this. So you do have the act,
yep.
and
wonderful.
This was approved on January 13th.
You all do have it,
yep.
correct?
Okay. Yep.
And I am going to be writing a letter, thank you, to both Senator Rosenberg's office, Representative Kulik, and also to the governor's office,
wonderful.
Thanking for all yeah. their support, because there were a lot of people. There were several days we just sat there not knowing.
Right.
We kept calling and nudging along.
Yep.
So bottom line is we're an official edict, and I'm not saying we weren't before, but now this sums it up. So
congratulations. This is great work.
So,
thank you.
Yeah. More work to come. Just a quick update. We're, as you can see, the sign we had over the summer installed on the West Drive that identifies all the businesses there. Atlantic Furniture is doing some great stuff in there. We got a tour in there in August. I had not stepped in that building since I left employment back in 1982, and I'll tell you, it's amazing what Mark's done with that.
Great.
So
good.
We're going to be cleaning out. I have three projects with Kevin. We're going to get the culverts cleaned out under the east and west drives. We have a storm grate that needs repair. And now we've identified all the swales in the easement, utility swales. So now, Kevin, we're going to be able to get in there and clean out and allow the movement of water. Not saying it isn't moving, but it's about 30 years of
right.
no cleaning out. So
right.
I want you to know I appreciate that, especially we're trying to eliminate mosquito places.
Believe me, yeah. yeah.
Oh, man.
So anyways, so that's formally presented. And like I say, now we can, we've been busy, you know, in the meantime with this, but now we'll just.
Paul, I really appreciate
great.
You so much
great
work on
this.
Thank you.
So much.
We will keep it up, and thank you for the support sure. you've given us. And thank you.
Thanks.
Thank
Have
you.
A great
yep.
night.
Next item on the agenda is PVMA Craft Fair. Tim, do you want to come up? How nice to see you.
How are you?
Very well, thank
good.
You.
Good,
good. It's when you get to,
oh, okay.
to vote on this issue.
Okay.
Well, we're here for our permits and street closing for September 23 and 24
okay.
for the 42nd fall craft fair. And also there's a, we have a request for a transient vendor waiver, which nonprofits can put into for to avoid lots of paperwork in Boston. So.
And we normally just to let you guys know, we normally waive the fees for PVMA.
Mm-hmm.
I have that in this motion.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yep.
So. And John Pachort, chief, is fully informed. And
yep.
And we work with the building inspector on the tents, and we do have everybody pay the fees on that. So.
Yeah. I know.
Because there are a lot of tents.
There's a lot of inspections. I did it 1 year with Dick.
Do you want me to read this?
Yep.
Okay. So, I make a motion to vote to grant all necessary approval for PVMA Craft Fair on September 23rd and 24th. Let's see, I'm trying to read some writing here.
I know,
here.
Sorry. when working with the police chief?
Yes, okay. that the traffic and detail would be coordinated with the chief of police and all the fees are waived.
I'll second the motion.
If there is no more further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Great. Thank you, guys. And Tim, did you have anything you wanted to update us on? Because we haven't been here for a while.
Well, watch for your invitation to our opening in June. We're doing an exhibit on the dinosaur footprints of the valley.
Oh, cool.
And Deerfield's part of that is Professor Hitchcock was born on what is now the Deerfield Academy grounds.
But, oh, is that right?
He and his wife, Ora White Hitchcock, became very, very important. They're sort of lost later when the big bones are found, the early scientists. But this will be celebrating their contribution. It's part of a larger National Endowment for the Humanities and Institute for Museum and Library Services and Mass Cultural Council project that has been promoting tourism of this part of the Connecticut River Valley around the dinosaur tracks.
That's fantastic. Really neat.
And I think the key piece for PVMA is the history part. That we're working with the Science Museum in Boston. We also work with them, but the Science Museum in Springfield and the Discovery Center up in Turner's, so there's it's a region-wide. But the story of women in science is especially important. Mm-hmm. That's our main theme, is that Ora White was the first woman to have a credit in a scientific, as an illustrator in a scientific publication.
Wow. Well, how neat. How neat.
Though, of course, she got it as Mrs. Hitchcock.
Sure.
But still.
That's right.
So it's a worthy story, and we hope to encourage a lot of girls to take an interest in science, as well as the boys. Everyone loves dinosaurs.
Yes.
Yes, that's the winning topic. So that's wonderful.
Great work.
So hope you'll be able to make
absolutely.
It.
Absolutely.
We will.
Great.
Thank you, Tim.
Thank you. Yeah, thanks
have
so
a nice
much.
Evening.
Yes, take care.
How old are the dinosaurs' tracks from around here?
Let's don't let them go before we
get
an answer.
Tim, how old are the tracks? Should we say 150 million? That's what?
It's Jurassic period.
Jurassic.
Okay.
So it's
I saw the
in
movie.
That.
Right, we haven't invited any of them to attend.
Mosquitoes are older.
Bring them back. They are working on it.
Oh, yeah.
I guess where I was going with that is maybe this is not really global warming. It's just another cycle of warm weather.
It's mine.
Maybe.
It happened before.
Maybe.
I think that the Historic Commission is here to see us. Are you
well?
Not this warm.
Yes.
Is this what you forgot to put on?
Yes.
No,
yes, it was on the previous agenda, and then it didn't happen, and I didn't move it forward. So, since you finished with the scheduled appointments, other than, well, John will stop by after the Finance Committee meeting.
Yeah. So. Jane, we would just come on up.
Hello, Jane.
Hi.
She travels light.
Oh, cool.
Are those some of the pictures that you talked about? Oh, Jane, that's wonderful.
Would you like me to hold that so the camera can see? Are you
Henrietta,
going to be talking
thank you for
about
coming.
That right now?
I might as well start with this.
Okay.
Okay. So, Betty Hollingsworth, do you know who Betty Hollingsworth is?
Yep, I did not.
Well, you're missing something.
I'm sure.
And you've missed it because she recently just died.
I heard that.
And she is this amazing source. There are probably a few other people like her, but she was a particularly friendly person. And she collected stuff about the town, either in albums, which she kept meticulously well, or in this fashion, and then in this place, in her head, an incredible memory. So we taped her. We have about 6 hours of interview with her.
Oh,
Jane,
that's so nice.
It just goes on and on and on about, she can point to a building, she can tell you the five owners of that building. And she worked for the second guy who didn't know she was 11, and when he found out, he fired her. And you know, and all, one thing leads to another. And she just takes you down the street and tells you about everything. And she worked for the school for many, many years and knew everybody that way. She offered these to the high school, and they didn't want it.
Oh, yeah.
So she's donated to the Historical Commission all of her albums of pictures,
right,
which were melding into the interview, but then we're going to think of, and we're getting all digitalized at very high level so we can put them on the TV and
great.
Do something with them.
Wonderful.
And then we have all this stuff. So we're suggesting that some of it hang here. And, it occurred to me that even though that's a dark wall, we could do something about that, that might be a nice place for permanent. Permanent is boring, but if you change things, people start noticing a little bit more and they look forward to seeing another something. And we could just rotate her pictures.
I think it's a fabulous
idea. Yeah.
And I mean, think
people love to find themselves history. At things like that. Right?
Or their relatives or whatever.
Yeah.
I think you could, you know, the brick wall would be an issue if you were trying to pound in things, but if you ran a system...
No, a system across the
top,
and
then you could hang it and you could change out all kinds of combination of pictures, and it would be relatively inexpensive and very doable
and maybe we could
easy.
Add a little light.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great
well,
idea, Jane.
If it's energy efficient.
Wonderful.
Did they both
melodies.
Get introduced? I'm not sure.
What's that?
What?
I don't know if they both got introduced.
Oh, you know what?
Yeah,
no,
and
you know what? Henrietta and Jane, can you just
I'm
give
Jane
a little,
Trudier, and
a
I'm coming
background.
Here. And Henrietta?
Coker. And
don't
I'm
be
here.
Embarrassed. I
never call her by her last name. That's okay. People mash up my last name, too. We're both on the Historical Commission.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
That's the end of the Historical Commission piece.
Okay.
Great.
Although you
well,
came for...
I came for to be a representative of the Historical Commission for the old grammar school to save it.
Okay. We have a...
Well, what has happened is I put out the call, you know, I said that we need a committee, I think, to look at the project there.
Mm-hmm.
And,
okay.
People have talking, and there a lot of people have come out interested in the grammar school, and I've gotten back to people who have said anything to me that we're not looking at that right now. Mostly it's the transition to another building. We're, you know, I think we can say this. I don't think we...
You don't think we'll get...
No, no.
Okay.
It's not determined at this point because we're waiting for the Attorney General's office to clear it for approval. But the church next door has indicated its desire to give us the building, give the town the building. And the conversation has been to move the senior center there. We've already been using it. So we need to prepare for that immediately.
It's the only old building, historic building, in the center of South Deerfield. Everything else is gone.
You're talking about the senior center or the church?
Senior center.
Okay. What we're going to do, Henrietta, is we're going to focus for this budget year on Kip has given us a rough estimate of $150,000 to $200,000, just eyeballing it. We have to get more definitive.
I understand.
I mean, the poor thing has got to do some work on it. We've got to figure out what we're going to do to actually nail down some dollar amount.
For
but
the church.
We are, for the church.
Yes. Church, right.
We are doing it for this budget year, for this town meeting.
It's not likely that in this year anything will happen to the building.
Right.
That
maybe
gives
to
us
the senior center.
That gives us more than a year to work on our research to prove that this is a valuable building.
Right.
Well, but the idea is we're going to move the seniors over as soon as we can because it will be a more bright, healthful, more space, and just a wonderful environment. So we're going to anticipate that. Hopefully, I'm not going to get in trouble by talking about it. And then what we're going to do is we're going to rehab or whatever, but we are going to do subsidized senior housing. And we have the ability to borrow against our CPA money if we don't have enough. But the intent is to, we're following Sunderland's doing their senior housing, subsidized housing. And we're hoping to do an RFP similar to that and find a partner and use some of our CPA money towards making sure we have absolutely subsidized senior housing in town. And I'm so excited about it. After all these years, it's like everything is coming together, and hopefully it will happen very fast.
Mm-hmm.
And so we will add your name Nothing is happening at the moment. And like I said, we haven't really even talked about it.
I have later on the agenda to appoint some people, mm-hmm. but it's to this what I call the phase one, not the grammar school.
Right.
But so what we'll do is put your name down for the phase two.
Right.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And I don't want people to get... We need to look at it.
I understand. It's not going to happen in a minute.
Right. No. But my intention is to make it happen very soon. So the church is this year, the next year, in the next budget year, 2019, would be the appropriation for the senior center, and we will, I mean, the senior subsidized housing, the old senior center. And that is what
I think if you call it the old grammar school, it'll work better in terms of this problem of...
Okay. And and probably that's what we're going to have to do. We're going to have to be definitive. But I was not even supposed to be talking about it, but I don't know. I mean, everybody knows about it. It's
the church's intention.
Yes, yeah. It's right. The intention of the church. They're so wonderful to
we need
do
town
this.
Oh, and yeah, our town great. Together yeah. our information in order to answer any questions that right. might be attended.
And we're trying to do this, in, you know, is speed... speedily as possible, expediently
so,
as possible.
I will just mention that other people have come forward for your benefit and the board's benefit who said, I know someone who has taken old buildings and just because they were so devoted to that regard, you know, regardless of the cost, they would be interested in looking at the building to develop it for senior housing to see if that is feasible to save the historical, you know, facade or exterior
right, yeah.
of the building. So I know a lot of people do not think that's possible, and we have a report that you can read it different ways from the report. But I know a lot of people care a lot about the building from a historic perspective.
Yeah.
And so we'll be going through that process, and it will be an open process.
It will.
Government.
Oh, yeah.
The idea is to build as many small units that so people will, you know, they're cheery and light and they'll be truly subsidized. In other words, no matter what your income is, you're only going to pay 30% of whatever income you have. So, I mean, if you get an $800 Social Security check, you're going to pay 30%. That's it. And this is truly subsidized housing. And
what
we would do would go through the process, and then we would turn it over to the housing authority to administer, because obviously we don't want to take on the extra expense of having to do that. And the housing authority, of course, is set up to do that.
Right.
They do the senior centers, I mean the senior subsidized housing in all the
old
little
state?
Towns. The Franklin Housing Authority.
Franklin.
Yeah. We just, for whatever reason, we've not been able to work with them to actually get a project off the ground.
There hasn't been money available. Really,
yeah,
for them
we
to
missed
do
the
it.
Boat, and so it just hasn't come together. But we're really determined to do this, and we're going to move very fast. So I appreciate your willingness to volunteer, because it's going to get done. And
good.
I mean, I've gone to meetings for 20 years, and I'm just done going to meetings. We're going to get stuff done. And I'm so excited, because this is just, the church is the one that is making this happen.
I think Henrietta's point is to save the building,
well,
the old grammar school. That I think that is her.
Yeah. But we're going to have senior housing, and that's ultimately the goal, and hopefully it will work out. You know,
some of us are interested in keeping some buildings. A lot of buildings have been made to disappear in the center of town, like we tore down the school that was right here, and then we watched some other buildings burn down, and then we've lost a lot of interesting architecture.
I love old buildings. I'm not, but we are going to get senior housing. So we'll figure out the idea of working together, and it will be 100% transparent, and hopefully we'll come out where everyone is truly excited and very happy about this, okay? So I appreciate
right.
you volunteering, because we're going to need a committee
mm-hmm.
and to make this happen. It will take some time.
Okay. All right.
Thank you. It's a small commitment time-wise, in the sense that over the period,
it's not an overnight thing.
But it...
Good things
take
time.
It's an intense... I was just going to say, it's going to be an intense kind of schedule, so... But I think people will feel really gratified that we're going to have, you know, that our goal is here and we're going to get it.
Yep.
And will happen.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane.
I'm here for something else.
You got some more?
Yeah. Another topic. Not historical.
Well, it's your expertise. I appreciate it.
That's just getting rid of it. I'm here for something else.
Oh, okay.
So,
Jane, I love talking to you. You're always enthusiastic. So, go ahead.
Wow. I would have prepared better. I know I was going to get
pressure's on.
There is an ad hoc town common committee that was formed rather casually under the direction of our last interim town administrator, and the advice he gave me was form a little committee, don't make it too big, and let's get started getting some interesting information. I was concerned about just the look of the town common, and I had heard that Doug was making it one of his top interests to work on the town common, so I went to speak to him. And he said, good. So that, I can't remember when that happened exactly. I then tried to collect the efforts that had been done for the work on the town common. And there's actually very little that's specifically on the town common. I found, first of all, I found by looking at Betty Hollingsworth's files, that in 1906, the fountain was added to the town
common. Oh, how cool. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Oh, that is really neat.
Yeah, 1906. And
maybe we should have a little plaque or something in there. No, just a little thing that's saying this was done. I mean, that's like a little tidbit that's probably not going to be remembered.
But, no, I think there is a thing to do, but maybe not a little plaque, but maybe something else.
Okay.
Like these informational.
Oh, that's a good idea.
Thing that gives you more than just that piece of information.
No, that's fine. I hate to see that kind of information get lost because that makes life interesting.
Well, it was just by chance that I found it because suddenly I had these boxes and boxes of stuff of Betty's and I was just pouring through them. But in 1997, Steve Upton re-energized the Sugarloaf Business Association. He was building his complex up there, and he wanted to make the center of town look a little nicer, too. And so he made that a topic that we all spoke about at this newly energized business association, which quickly died off after that. And I got the files for all of that from John Pachorik. He said, with my blessings, go try it again. Mm-hmm. It's someplace in my files now. So part of that was the UMass architecture department came in, and they did a study with the town, and they called it a charrette, and we did it recently again. And we met at the Polish-American Club, and the Conway Landscape School was involved, and they did a presentation for the downtown area of South Deerfield, not the common per se. And those just completely got lost. Nobody knows where they are here. But I went to the Conway School, and I have them now, a copy. And now you have a copy.
Yes, we have copies for people.
The next thing that happened...
And that was in 1997?
1997.
I think I have copies of that in one of my boxes.
Uh-huh. The next... Joe Gorey told me that Joe Filipowski replaced the fountain some... He thinks it's 20 years ago, but it must be more like 25 because I'm here 24 years and it hasn't been replaced since I'm here. So that's just a random information. I don't have any other. Then FERCOG
did a traffic calming plan in 2001. And then in 2012, we got a grant to do the complete streets. Yep. And that took, that was really looking at the same areas, again, the same problems of pedestrian, the traffic, the electric wires, this signage, the whole thing. A lot of pedestrian and car traffic issues and bicycle things. And I don't have that with me here, but it's online on our website. And then is this effort here today. So I said to Doug, why don't we ask the Conway School to come and just focus, and they do a sort of a cheap thing. It's their student project, and it's only as good as what that is. And he said, I have the money, and so that's what we went ahead, and I applied, and they picked, I applied personally also, but I didn't get picked, but the town got picked, and it cost the town $450, and the student came and did her work. So that was this piece here, and you have copies of that as well. It's some 15 pages. And it's her assignment. I have to stress this because we told her what we were looking for. And so this committee, by the way, is Trevor McDaniel, Diane Gripko, and Mary Andronopoulos. And I invited somebody from Open Space to come if she wanted to, or they wanted to, and Corinne Dugas is the person who's shown interest but hasn't actually come to any meetings. And I contacted John Siz, who is the chair of the Memorial Day. I thought that was an important person to involve. And then I thought to involve Darren Gray, who was instrumental or
he was one of the
People
main
for the complete streets,
right?
He said he was really not available, but to keep him in the loop. But I think I have, by the way, two ways of reaching him, both of which are not accurate. I don't think he's gotten one thing from me. So here's what we told this student to do. We told her that after our meeting, and we each contributed what we liked about the town common and what we didn't like and what we were hoping to see. And I forwarded all my minutes, I think, to you yesterday, and I will forward them to you. I had neglected to do that. And I have for you my last minutes. You can follow me on them, but primarily
has
the list of things that we want to do. That we agree.
Okay.
To.
No, I'm good. I've set the meeting. So.
I think Trevor needs it.
I'm good. I'll follow along. You hang on to it. You've done another? Okay. Page two.
The questions I had, which has not really been resolved, and it's one I keep bringing up again, is how do things get decided? And so I thought, okay, so if I'm going to put up a building or make a change on my building, I have to go to the building inspector, and he has to approve my plans. And we pay him for that. But if there's a tree in front of my house that's on not on my property but on town property but in front of my house, and I'm afraid the limbs are going to come down or something, I go to the DPW. They have a tree person there. If we think we need a sign on some corner or something, how does that decision get made? That I can see how the police might decide something, or the DPW might decide something, no parking, stop sign, whatever. But who decides, for instance, where exactly it goes? And so that's an overriding question. We get grant money for doing something ecological or, you know, sound in terms of the solar stuff. And, oh, we got some money from that. We can apply for that. Oh, we can put a solar trash container. Here, go buy it, DPW, and put it someplace. Who gets to decide exactly? So I can see, I'm trying to imagine how it would be. You come, you say, oh, I'm you come to the select board and say, we got the money for this, and we like to put it in the town common. And there it falls, but how it gets placed is an interesting problem. So I just felt that there was no mommy or daddy that was sort of watching over the incremental accumulation of things. And so that's the overriding. That was my personal overriding thing.
I would just like to comment that I'm very appreciative that you included John Siss, because the Memorial Day is probably our biggest use of the common.
Yes.
And so having that be accommodating to that event is huge.
It was fantastic talking to him. First of all, I never met him. And he showed up the same day that I was meeting the student for the first time. The student, I should say, is not like an 18-year-old. She's like a 38-year-old. She's a former town urban planner who's changing careers. So she was listening to me while I was speaking to him. And then, I spoke to each separately. But I asked him, I said, how do you decide? I'm glad you brought him up. How do you decide what direction and where you place things in the town common for the Memorial Day events? He said, I don't know. We always seem to be doing it the same way. We did it last year this way. We do it. I said, so it's not like on purpose that you aim in one particular direction, like at Cumberland Farms for your speakers, so we're all watching Cumberland Farms. He said, no.
Probably not.
I said, don't you think it's much nicer looking up North Main Street? He said, yes. I said, all our musical events are facing that way, you know, in the summer. I said, why don't you switch it around? He said, I don't know. I never thought about it. So I said, how do you feel about the fact that one memorial stone's over there and one's over here? He said, well, what would you do? I said, well, look what Sunderland did. He said, yeah, that's really nice. So he was actually, he said, but he was very cautious to say, but if we did any changes, it would have to be passed by the select board. I said, well, of course. But to have an area that's more focused for the two stones, for instance, together, I said, it's not a burial after all. It's just a stone. And to put them and to maybe have some design that makes them like a more contemplative kind of place. One of them is at a very busy intersection. Anyway, that's about John Siss. Anyway, so this is what we told Emily of the Conway student. We're looking for a low-maintenance planting plan. Oops, my typing is, I wrote planting, but it was supposed to be planting plan.
Mm-hmm. Jane, don't worry. I understood what you were trying to say.
Yeah, well, earlier, I looked at my minutes and I said, who wrote these? I was learning how to do the dictation, the voice dictation, and it doesn't work very well for me. And then we talked about, I said, we're looking for the improvement of pedestrian access and paths and, you know, what could happen here. And then the coherence between the freestanding features. So I mentioned one, which were the two memorial stones. But in the freestanding features, you've got three benches now. You've got the trash compactor, the solar trash can. You have the electric hut. You've got a bike rack. You've got a drinking fountain. You have a hydrant. You have a flagpole. And you have the two memorial stones. So without saying that anything has to leave, it's just like, how are they
connected
or how do you disconnect them? I had a rather harsh statement about the solar thing. I think it's hideous, but I think it's even disrespectful, because it's actually the same scale as the memorial stones. And it's this, it's just like, oh, and that's the other memorial stone. Anyway, she bested us by adding a thing we had not occurred to anybody, to enhance the ecological function with stormwater management features and expanded tree canopy. And she has a whole page on it. I have to admit that I know very little about this. And so I remind everybody on the committee, this is not our plan. This is just some background information. We don't have a plan yet. I can't find it.
Jane, I don't want you to think that I'm terrible, but I don't want to cut you off too much. But
time. Okay. I'll speed up.
Can you speed up just a dash? Because I had made a promise to Wendy
okay.
that I would be done within an hour, hour and a half, every single meeting.
Uh-huh.
And I
but
know,
Wendy forgot me on this program. So
I know.
But I won't abuse it. Here I go. Okay. So
thank
she
you, Jane.
She brought us some things to look at, which are very nice. She brought us a whole book that was done on the study of town commons by some local people. She brought us information about the economic values of nature and the assessment of ecosystem services on forestry and tree canopies, and something else I can't remember, but I wrote it down here. And then, of course, her report. Now, the second side is what, at our meeting, we managed to agree upon, and that was really entirely thanks to Trevor, frankly. Here's what we're proposing to do. I pointed out, and I just was out there before the meeting to look at this again, I'd like to point out that the crosswalks are not marked. We did some new paving in front of Jerry's place on North Main, and the crosswalks have not been put back in. The ones coming from Cumberland Farms sort of stop about 10 feet before they reach the common. It needs to be cleaned up.
Yeah.
So those two crosswalks are major crosswalks that people use a lot. And yet, when they come to the town common, they meet grass. There's no walk that they join. In fact, there's a walk on the town common that goes toward Cumberland Farm, but you don't want people going there and crossing there because there's no crosswalk. And it's, I don't know, 20 feet back from the corner. So there's this misleading, it's pathways that come from an earlier time, perhaps, mm-hmm. where the cars were not the way they are now. And there's another place that people cross, there's no crosswalk, and that's from the corner of Grave Street to the tip that goes down to,
yep.
Right. So we couldn't agree on everything, but we agreed on this one, which was to create an entry point there to the town common with some pathway that would lead straight to the fountain. Where is that? That's number three. The perimeter buffer, which I thought was a really inadequate and trashy little sidewalk, is, according to Joe, not a sidewalk. It was meant as a place to, when you're getting out of your car, it was made for the cars. You wouldn't be stepping in the grass or in the mud. And it's in terrible disrepair. And now I understand that it's not a sidewalk, because why would you put a post box, a U.S. post box, right in the middle of it? Clearly it's not a sidewalk. I had not thought of it that way before. So that's what this drain, storm drain system thing. She was suggesting some permeable landscaping that goes in there. That's not something that needs to be mowed all the time, but I don't know much about this. Maybe it isn't planting. Maybe it's something else. Mm-hmm.
They have a block system. They have a block system that I went to a demonstration on, and it was actually very impressive, and it's pretty. Mm-hmm. And they have used it now in New Hampshire and Maine both long enough now that it will withstand. I mean, it's proven that it can withstand our weather.
Well, she also pointed out that the common is about a 2-degree slant down from the streets. So all the water from the cars and whatever's on the street is coming down to the common and is affecting whatever's planted around there, obviously. But she's suggesting by the proper planting or plop or whatever, you can actually filter that stuff before it hits the storm water system and into the Connecticut River.
Our roads have leveled and multiple layers of asphalt. Everything's kind of sunk in.
That's what happened. So so we're more research to do on that. Mm-hmm. So that was number one. I went out to count my signs. There are 16 signs. And I thought I'd have it ready to be printed to show you, but you can go and find them yourselves. There's 16 signs, and there got to be there. I know that there's some redundancies. We have two signs on the corner of North Main and Sugarloaf for the information of what street you're on. One is for Sugarloaf, and one is for North Main, right next to each other. And there's a lot of signage. So the place looks like the place you dump stuff on. And that's without the signs that go temporarily up for the recreation and the whatever that goes over there as well. So this is designed by elimination. And so my job is to go and to show this to the DPW and to the police and say, can you look this over and see what can be eliminated or combined?
Combined, yep.
And I will send copies of whatever I discover. Three. And then the last, and there were only four things we could agree upon, and we didn't touch the solar trash container, was that maybe another bench would be nice. But there's an attachment to the benches as they are, and they've been cleaned. But I was just there again this afternoon. Two boys were eating huge bars of chocolate. I want you to know they were using for their scooters. They went and parked their scooters through the snow in the bike rack. I was very mystified and impressed by that fact because I always think it's funny to have a bike rack very far from a water fountain. If you were a biker and you wanted to stop, you might want the bike rack to be near the water fountain, the drinking fountain, sorry. Anyway, there they went to get, and then they sat down on the bench to eat these enormous bars of chocolate, and their feet don't touch the floor. I'm thinking, these are not short kids. And I went to sit on the bench across from them, and my feet don't hit the floor. And I said, do you mind if I take a picture? I can take your faces out. And I told him, so I took a picture. Then I asked him to take a picture of me. And you can't really see from the picture, but you have to. You have to go try it out. The benches look like they've tipped back. And what Emily had suggested is that when you are elderly or disabled, you need an armrest. She said that'd be nice to have benches with armrests. So we agreed that to add a bench, maybe in similar style, I would like to recommend that the benches that we have get straightened. And I know that's not an easy job. And everyone, including John Siz, even mentioned it himself. Why aren't the benches around the fountain instead of off in different directions like that? So some review of where the benches are and an addition of a bench. And I would like to add, although it wasn't discussed in committee, that the ones that we have may be straightened. Mm-hmm. That's it.
Jane, I really appreciate it, and I hope you understand. I wasn't really trying to cut you off on this, because this is very
that's okay
good conversation.
It's great work.
I poor. poor Wendy. I mean, we're so happy to have her. That
we just want don't want her to leave.
That's right.
See, one of these rooms you could really, make into
really,
a bedroom.
And you can ask anyone. I'm not a problem staying all night, but with Wendy here, I'm.
Before I agreed to work here, I extracted things from people as a promise, and with Carolyn, it was that we have meetings that are no longer than an hour and a half.
An hour. Well, we're trying.
And under my breath, I said, well,
that being said.
But
yes.
She didn't hear that.
So we're trying very hard, and I'm, you know, under the gun. She's so valuable that it's really worth the sacrifice.
Well, I recommend that because people come and talk and have their occasion to talk, like Henrietta. She wasn't on any agenda here, right? That you let the other people do most of the talking and you do less. Did I say that?
Yeah, but sometimes I'm enthusiastic too. You know, Kip will tell you, you know, he doesn't want to hear any more about that.
I was just thinking we had insects and dinosaurs in one conversation. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking the insects won.
Yes, they do. Yeah, they always do. They've killed more people than anything else.
But
they've
lasted.
Coming back.
They lasted forever and ever, and the dinosaurs are gone.
I know.
Here long after we're
yep.
gone.
That's because they don't worry about global warming. They don't worry about.
I don't think the dinosaurs worried about anything either.
No, they're gone.
Jane,
thank you so much. Jane.
Clearly, you care a lot, and I just want to say thank you.
Yep.
Because
we
care very much, and I will take your suggestion of coordinating. We'll figure out.
Yeah.
This is
we'll
further discussion on this on how to coordinate and how to make decisions.
Can I just touch on one thing?
Sure.
The question: what is the protocol? Someone wants to put something on the common. I suggested at the meeting, I also attended the meeting, mm-hmm. that it should go through this board. There needs to be a conduit. You
yes.
can't. Everyone just can't put up whatever they want. You're likely to say yes, especially if it's something temporary. But, you know, it is good, and I think this is where you're coming from, is to have some kind of policy and thinking about it. Town commons are very special in
mm-hmm.
history. And I actually, years ago, did two commons projects in the town, one in the town of Huntington, one in Chester, because there was a state grant program, particularly for redesigning or restoring commons. So at any rate, that's a whole other conversation, but I just wanted to bring up the question of what and you've been on the board the longest, Karen, so you know the history of sort of what policy you followed, whether it's written or not, about permission.
I think it boils down to who's interested, and I can say that I have always had an interest, and so, you know, I mostly say that it's probably my fault that it's so disconnected because, you know, I try to, whoever wants to show interest, you want to say yes.
But people come forward, if someone comes forward.
And that's what I mean, we need to have a process, and we should have an overarching plan.
But you have to be very careful because there are people who care and who've been doing things, like Diane has been. This is a project, right? And everybody, nobody is doing anything intentionally wrong or bad. Everybody is, it's always goodwill.
So you have to think
very carefully about how to say so that people are not feeling that they're unappreciated.
Correct.
That's right.
Correct.
And or discouraged from
getting
interested, getting mm-hmm. involved, but also just because, I mean, we need to have a plan. So it would be lovely to have a spatial kind of overview and move things around. And I'm, like I said, I'm glad you incorporated John Sids because we do use the common for the Memorial Day. And it would be lovely to look down south, Sugarloaf, which is a lovely,
Sugarloaf
beautiful.
Or Maine.
Or Maine.
Either one.
Whichever one. Is lovely to look down compared to looking at Cumberland Farms. So, I mean, there's a lot of things we could decide, and so.
Unless you put Putt's block back
up
there.
Can you just keep on this?
We will.
Trevor will take point on this, and we'll figure this out.
Some historical. Oh, those are postcards, aren't they?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Wow, that's really pretty. I mean, we've been hustling for Trump money for a while, and that was why we did the complete streets, because that's just like the first
stepping
thing you
stone.
Check off to be able to apply for certain things.
Oh, well, from the perspective of somebody who's watching it from the outside, although I participated in the charrette they had, it's like, so now what?
So now you wait for money.
Yeah. But
well, you know, it's not
streets,
as if
the complete
people...
streets was the next step to do the checkoff so that you can apply for funds and grants, because that is an official thing. Our charrette, even though it was very viable and there was a lot of participation and people, I saw people that I've never seen before participate and they were really excited, but there was no money attached to that process and it didn't give us access to
do
anything.
Do you have the names of all the people who were participating so as to keep them informed of what's next?
What's next is we got Wendy on board. Then we need to get our executive assistant so that we'll free her up to actually write grants for stuff.
What I'm saying is that that's a really important piece of information that, you know, the public doesn't know exactly, well, what happened. It becomes like a joke. Oh, we did another one of those plans, and, you know, now nothing is going to happen.
Well, it's like the open space thing. One time in the winter, I was very bored, and I read it, 130-something pages. And what struck me, and it really did bother me the most, is it closed with, this is the will of the people. 32 people took part in that. And it troubled me that, how can the will of 32 people be what the town of Deerfield wanted, you know?
How many people come to vote at the town meeting?
I think it was voted at town meeting, so it was at least approved at town meeting.
Approved.
But I mean, that's
hundred.
Yeah.
Okay,
I mean, we're between
two or three hundred. That's the extent of the involved polity.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, we've tried everything to get people involved.
It's happening.
Sorry, I'm hungry.
Yeah, it's happening. And keep calling, keep writing. We want to hear from you. We'll figure out ways for people to get there.
I've asked, and I don't think it exists, for a job description of every volunteer committee and board on...
We started that, and I have
I
at
want
least
to see
half
it
of those
on
done.
On the website to say, oh, I might be interested in open space. What is it? What am I expected to do? And an explanation. I have no real clear idea what it is. Or if I wanted to be a selectman, what does it actually amount to?
Don't say anything, Kip.
No,
30
I
or 40 hours a week.
Yeah, I know that. So let me take another one. If you want to
be upgrading
never
the
mind.
We're going to upgrade the website.
That would get me interested.
Things.
I would say, wow, I could do that.
Well, Jane, I had a 12-hour day yesterday, and I have a 12-hour day today.
No, I know I don't want to be a select person. That's fine. I got that point.
But you will offer help, as you are doing now, which is wonderful.
Yeah.
And on the Historic Commission.
Okay. Yep.
Thank you, Jane. I'm sorry.
Thanks,
I don't
Jane.
Mean to cut you off. Okay. We're going to take the sewer abatement request under advisement and continue that.
It's been withdrawn.
Yeah.
One of them.
Kip, did you have the INI project that you wanted to discuss?
Yes and no.
We
that one was withdrawn.
The recommendation from the sewer study committee was that we sign a commitment with Dave Prickett Associates.
Okay.
I think that's what it was. To do the initial part of that. A concern was that it was $4,300, but it's going to end up being a larger amount. And that we were concerned that if the overall amount breaks the threshold of, I don't know if it's $50,000 or something like that, then are we going to be in trouble because we didn't put it out for bid?
I thought you said it was 4,300. How does it get from
4,300
to
50,000?
50,000.
Because it's an ongoing process. It takes a lot of
but
work.
But don't. The only thing that I was concerned
it's
about.
Bid splitting because.
Okay.
That's what. He's
the only thing that I was concerned was that we capture the spring flows
exactly.
So that we can make the report in December and not be in violation of anything and get fined.
I understand.
So can we do part of it enough to? Get the spring flows and not miss that part that would get us in trouble and then make a decision later on for the other parts?
Well, that's what our that board was unclear of, and I really don't know the answer.
Well, I don't know exactly what's being proposed. Is it being proposed that you're going to contract, and then it's got phases, and he'll be doing them? Or is it just, so that's
so
one contract.
So it is a one contract, even though we vote the $4,300 initially, so we catch the... The thing is, we're running out of time.
We're running out of time. So we have to make that decision. People like Bruce Hunter, had done a lot of research, and they thought that this was a good way to go because we need to get this going.
He knows. He does procurement.
Right. But that's where the subject came up of, this could end up potentially being more than $50,000. So if it does... Then what do we do then? Because now we're already into it.
Are you signing a contract for $50,000?
No.
Okay, then.
It would be $4,300. So let's just do the $4,300. Okay. And that will get us through the spring flows?
Yes.
Okay. Let's worry about the rest later on. Mm-hmm. We'll let Wendy research.
I'm going to procurement training next week. I'll ask the question.
Can you straighten us out?
It's always a problem. This comes up all the time, especially with engineering and design projects.
Sure. I thought if as long as you could have phases, can you just verify that when you do go through the training?
I know what the question is.
Okay,
it's a challenge.
I will make a motion to approve $4,300 to do the initial INI to capture the spring flows so that we will be in compliance and be able to file a report in December.
Second.
Is that good enough, Kip?
I believe so. Do we need to mention the name of the firm that we're going to sit with?
Oh, well, maybe Weston and Sampson. But
No, it's Prickett.
Is it Prickett? I mean, okay.
You're giving the money to the wrong people.
I know, sorry. we keep signing out bills to them. That was why it was on my mind.
That's where my initial question is.
Okay, so I don't think we need to name the person, just the amount of money, right? We have to authorize money.
Well, you're awarding a contract? Is that what you're doing?
I would say so.
Okay, so we've decided on him for sure. Yeah. Okay, then I will add that it be made out to, what is it, Prickett's?
Dave
Prickett?
Yep.
Okay.
Associates.
Okay. Do I have a second?
Second.
Oh, you did. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I wasn't paying attention. I was focused on Kip giving me, is it okay? All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, thank you very much. I was concerned about that.
Yep.
We have, next item on the agenda is to appoint special police officers.
I just got this afternoon.
They expire on June 30th, the part-time ones.
They don't, but their terms do.
Okay. Oh, well, yes. Oh, geez. Wendy, it's been a long time.
I know.
I've had to deal with too much mosquitoes today and sewage issues. Okay, so... Ralph Gould, Elizabeth Unitas, Christopher McDougall, and Mariska Smith?
Marissa
Smith.
Do I have a second?
Is there any further discussion?
My only question is, are these part-time people?
Yes.
Oh, yes. No, yes. Our full-time don't have terms that expire.
They're finished the backgrounds on them.
These are the part-time. Yeah, these are the part-time specials. If all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, please make that unanimous. John will be happy that is done. Next item on the agenda is to appoint Senior Center Committee, Richard Kalaszewski, Don Nove, Deborah Dacus.
She's going to be, it's gracious, so it's dacious.
Dacious.
Yes. Gracious.
Okay, and Ken Schoen. I want to thank them to absolutely appreciate them volunteering, and we and thank them. And do I have a second?
Second.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Good.
I'd just like to say something about this. We really need to get,
This
is my proposal to get a committee together to focus in on the questions we need answered if we can go forward by town meeting. Deborah Dacus lives here in town, and I know her as a colleague. She retired not too long ago as the three-year economic development director and planner for Agawam. So she's got a lot of experience with doing, you know, knowing what you need to do to figure out what to do.
I'm really, that makes sense. I'm really excited. I'm so excited that she wants to do this.
I think this would be a short-term project here. Yeah. And it doesn't mean other people cannot be involved, but this is very focused now on how we get from, you know, here to there. On, and I will just acknowledge also that the CPA applications are due March 1st, which is within the next few days. So, and I did go to their meeting the other night and let them know about that. So we'll do the best we can. I will do the best I can.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if Kip can just, if you can add a little bit more to the ballpark figure. I mean, you said 150 to 200.
Let's talk on Friday, Kip, if you're available. That would be great.
I mean, it's such a big target because there was nothing identified as to what specific work we're going to do. You know, so it's really just, you know, that's a lot of money, and you can do a lot of work with that. So if I was, say, I was giving a budget of $100,000, then you prioritize, you know, what is it that, you know, are code violations,
ADA,
or code upgrades, ADA, and things like that, and then you go along. I think that's a prudent way of dealing with that situation.
Okay.
I agree.
Well, we
might need, I don't know, and I need to clarify because I did the research and I have the letter, but I'm not certain that we could actually use CPA money to do like a structural study or whatever to determine those things. Or we would have to come up with money elsewhere to do that.
But I don't think we need a study. No. Dick and I could go through the building, or I can do it. And you know, to see what's needed, and before we do work, we can hire a structural engineer to come in, and I can point out, look, if this is what we need, you know, look at this, see what we need to do, and stuff like that. And they can write a report and do, you know, whatever they need to do to obtain building permits. And if we're going to, you know, put it out to bid, then you know, they can prepare documents like that. And, you know, I can't imagine that that would be that much of a fee to do.
Okay.
I think that's the way.
Okay, let's talk on Friday, though.
Okay. The next item on the agenda is request comments from the on the condominiums at Sugarloaf. I don't know.
He wanted a from the final plans. You commented on the preliminary, and he wanted this, and the planning board.
What has changed since the?
Nothing.
Okay, I mean,
it's all the same. I think the applicant has really gone above and beyond what is required. He's addressed the groundwater issues. I know that there's probably a dozen people that are concerned about the groundwater in that area. But I do know that the applicant has hired four of some of the best qualified people in the area to do this.
Yeah.
And Dick, who has witnessed just about every perk test in our town for the last 10 or 12 years, also witnessed this and, you know, verified everything that was done. But as far as the buildings, their location, the road, I think everything is really good. Another topic of discussion was, why is there, you know, an entrance and an exit, or two entrances instead of one? The fire department likes having two ways in. You know, the traffic flow is going to be better. There's not going to be any more homes in that subdivision than there is on King Philip Ave across the street. There really doesn't seem to be a big traffic issue. It isn't like everybody's going to leave at once. And I don't see a negative side to it.
Had they gotten the okay from the state on the variance between, I think there was a space between entrance and or is that later on?
I don't know the definite answer, but it seems like every applicant that's come before the planning board, they always want to know, well, what did the state say yet? The state always reserves their judgment after they get local approval.
I see.
But local approval doesn't want to come until they know what the state wants to do.
Yeah.
So what do you do? But there seems to be no objections with this local office.
And with the police and the fire didn't seem to have an issue
with
that?
Nope. They, okay. You know, I've spoken with John about it,
yep.
And he has no issues.
Okay.
You know, I talked with Kevin about it, and
yeah,
the fire chief, and they all think the access is great.
Good.
So. Okay. I would just then say that our comments earlier should just be reiterated. I mean, we don't want open retention detention ponds, and I think design is reflective of that.
Right.
There still are some retention ponds, but it's part of our rules. So.
Yeah, but Kip, we can't have open detention ponds or retention ponds because they breed mosquitoes.
I guess I will agree with you, but as this board, we don't have the authority to sit here and say, oh, you can't do that. If
actually,
our bylaws
we do.
Says, we do?
As Board of Health, we overrule everything. If it's a public health issue, we have the ability to say no. And I am very serious about us not encouraging open retention detention ponds.
Because this is
serious.
I'm not saying it's not serious, but I don't. The way these work is the water is primarily, these retention ponds are used to slow the water's entry into the ground. It isn't like there's going to be an actual pond there. And it would probably only work during an extremely heavy rain event. Normal rain, the water would never get to it because it's always going to leach into
there. So what's the, are the engineers guaranteeing beyond 48 hours? Because beyond 48 hours, the mosquitoes are breeding.
It would depend on, I would say, it would depend on how much rain we got.
We had in a week or something like that, but I don't think it's designed to sit there for very long.
No,
we're
it's
not.
Not
going to have cattails and that kind of stuff.
Oh, no, not at all, because it's, first of all, it's very sandy over there.
And it's long.
The absorption rate is extremely quick.
Will it be mowed, do you think, those retention areas? That's going to be just going to
be
grass
meeting,
like a swale kind of thing.
It'll be no different than what you have at the elementary school right there.
Right.
Okay, so I guess I would just put it in writing that there just cannot be standing water for more than 48 hours. And that has been our stance as Board of Health for the last 4 or 5 years. This is not new because this is a public health issue. I brought it up earlier.
But if you get a lot, how can anybody guarantee that?
Well, it's supposed to be designed so that the system clears out in 48 hours or less.
But if you got enough rain, that wouldn't happen. It wouldn't happen at the elementary school either.
Well, the elementary school is already built in here. I'm talking about new development going forward, and I said that in the
preliminary
plan. That
so
was a condition.
Do we have any answers back from them on that? Do you know? Do we know?
No.
We could get.
Okay. I am absolutely.
These are comments.
Yeah.
So we could request.
Yeah.
Information to confirm.
I would look back at the preliminary comments and just pull the same comments because I made the same comments in the preliminary plan. That was my number one thing. We are not allowing mosquito breeding locations in town to be built. That's just it. We're spending money to fight mosquitoes. We're not going to let someone come and build mosquito places.
I understand you, but this is what goes on in this town. We have rules in place, and there are the people who have to comply with these rules say they're crazy. And we say to them, sorry, these are our rules. So now this board is now saying, I don't care what our rules say. I don't want to have a mosquito breeding ground. And I think it's unfair.
Yeah, but this was my comment from the very beginning.
Uh-huh.
That
but
this,
do you see what I'm saying? It's
yes.
Like
but this has been, our rules have not been revised to.
Let me put it this way. This message gets back to the applicant, and the applicant redoes this, and then it comes to the planning board, and the planning board says, well, it doesn't meet the stormwater requirements because you don't have retention area for that. Because these drywalls are going to fill up, then what are you going to do with the extra water?
Well, they
and
have
our
to be
rules
able.
Say you have to do this. And
yeah, but they can be able to be designed somehow so you don't have standing water.
Well, they're, none of them are made to be ponds. It's a retention pond for a short amount of time. And depending on the time is the saturation of the soil and how long it rains. If we got 12 inches of rain over a week's period, yeah, there's going to be standing water there.
Where would it normally go? I mean, it would,
I mean, can't you have underground? Anyway, can't you have underground retention areas? You can have underground transgenic.
And there are some. There are some, but you know, you still have mosquito larvae in catch basins, anyways. That's why they drop those tablets in there. You know,
but that's a doable thing that we would have to do, which is what we do now.
I maybe I'm getting it over my head because I don't know all of what's in their plans, but
okay. Well, I mean, my comment has been the same.
Yeah.
I think that they're trying to achieve both things. It address the water coming off and not have it stand there either. I think that area, well, it does in some areas people think it has a high water table, but I don't think it. I mean, but once they did those tests, they're down quite a ways, and it is pretty sandy. So I think the idea is like if it pours, of course you're going to get pooling of water like you would anywhere, but you know, in a pretty short amount of time, it recesses in.
They should be able to calculate 48 hours.
But if you're really that concerned about it, you take Bloody Brook from Route 5 to the monument. That's all swamp right there.
Kip, I know, and that's one of the places that we're trapping because it is one of the mosquito breeding areas.
Why not just go and clean it all out? Then you wouldn't have.
Well, that's one of my goals.
That's one of our goals. What we want to say is it is a public health hazard and that we can go in and do that.
There's a lot of people that live along there and live up on, I can't think of the name of the street right now, but across from the high school, they would love to have that swale cleaned out because they get water in their houses and everything.
Yep.
But it's like, oh, it's wetlands. So you can, well, the only reason it's wetlands is because nobody's ever taken care of it.
That's
but
right.
Kip, public health trumps everything.
I'm going to remember that, Carol.
If
I'm
we...
going to bring you by the hand and you say...
No. It trumps everything, let me tell you. So you can go in and with the public health.
We have a planning board meeting next week, and I'm going to say public health trumps your bylaws, guys. So you're good.
No, I'm really serious. We can say it's a public health hazard, and we can do stuff.
I'm not arguing with you. I'm just trying to see, you know, you're looking at it from your side. And if you're going
to
look at it from the other people's side, well, we're following your rules. We didn't make these rules.
I know.
Okay.
But sometimes the rules don't keep up with public health hazard, and really the mosquitoes thing is relatively new on the radar.
I will hold on to that, and I will use that.
It's on tape.
I'm not like being outrageous, but if
I
would just want to make sure that it's not standing water for beyond 48 hours.
I think that's their goal when they did that.
So as a select board, we are the board of health. So I'm a board of health agent.
Correct.
So at that planning board meeting, I can exert my authority as a board of health.
You may.
You can say,
yes,
you can convey that the board of health
is
very.
So they don't
have to store water. No. They have to be able to make sure that the design, design encompasses a way that the water is not sitting in the retention detention pond for more than 48 hours. Because beyond that.
Yep.
You have breeding potential.
Good. Yep. I got you, Chief. Next.
Okay. Sorry.
Well, do you want to vote and fill out the form?
Oh. Okay. We have to actually. I thought we could sign off on.
Okay.
It.
Sign off. Well, I just remembered a former meeting.
Okay. I will sign it right now, and
comments.
I am going to let Pat capture the conversation and print it in. How's that?
Preliminary comments and see what you had.
It's the same. Thank you, Pat. It's just, Kip, it just makes me crazy, though. We wouldn't want to.
I agree with you that I don't think that these things are good, and mosquitoes are the big reason. I'm just saying that, you know, you get one board who has one set of rules and another board has different. And what are the poor people supposed to do? They get caught in the middle. It's like, you know.
Maybe
well,
we
public health is more has more power than the police. So just remember that if should you want to
board
of health.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't get a badge.
Actually.
You don't get a badge.
You get a little vest. A little vest.
Is it orange?
A little vest. It has all kinds of stickers.
Oh, good. Where'd you get that from? I don't have one.
You have to go to a lot of meetings, Skip.
No, it's like
then you get like a little.
I was going to say, this reminds me of the Cub Scouts.
You know? Yeah. You got to get certain patches.
Yes,
oh,
okay. yes. It's a lot of
Wendy
hours.
Wendy wants to go home.
Yeah, I know. Okay, Wendy. Oh, wait, we have the administrative assistant rate adjustment. we had initially voted to continue a slight raise for Pat for the extra work until we were staffed with the town administrator. So we're approaching that timeline. And
should I move?
So hopefully you have less work, Pat, and less crazed. So I would sort that.
We make a, did we vote that last time where we had to make, do we have to vote that down now?
I think we have to pick a date, and I would say, the end of this pay period.
Yep, whatever pay period is.
Yep, and then we don't have to do anything formally, right?
You acted on the recommendation of Doug Finn's letter.
Right.
So.
And okay. So we just say that, the time has come. And
sure. I have to say, I really appreciate appreciate her being here and being in there when I'm here, which is, I'm here. Well, you're not here all the time, I mean, nobody is. I've been calling Pat Radar, if you remember Radar from MASH, because she takes good care of me.
She does.
Well, I can tell you that I am very much appreciative of the fact that she handled our office when
we stepped up.
That was a big,
no doubt about that.
That was a huge thing to juggle.
Task. It's frightening.
Yes.
And it was big. And she did. She carried on.
She was very patient with all my notes that she had to translate and produce. And I want you to know I appreciate that very much, because there was a lot of things that we all had to work together and keep us treading water, at least. And nobody drowned. We made it. And I'm so thankful. And nobody's in jail. And oh, my God. It was just, I'm so glad that.
Did you do something that?
Somebody's
drowned. No, not that I know of.
Okay.
But like I said, it is scary to be responsible for everything, and I really, really appreciate it, because it was tough. And I am just so thankful that Wendy's here, and that's why I am going to stop talking so we can get out of here.
I do want to say something about executive assistant. I had polled you about a possible temporary situation that isn't going to work out. So
okay.
I'm hoping to advertise.
Okay. Yep.
For the position. I'll say that. I'll keep saying that. I just hope if anybody out there is interested and has an interest in working full-time.
So are you going to actually advertise? I mean, have you gotten to the point where you can advertise yet?
No, because I'm trying to update the job description. And what
okay.
I have is...
Okay.
It's not just updating. It's a number of things.
Redesigning a bit.
Yeah, and I'll talk later about salary and things like that when we talk about budgets.
I'm hoping that there's not going to be any issue, because I would like to get this person on board, because one of the aspects of this drill was handling social media and spontaneous volunteers, which scares the heck out of me. So hopefully we're all going to practice that kind of stuff in an event. And this person, I wanted to make sure this person was going to be the social media
coordinating
competency in that. Okay.
I don't think you have to worry about spontaneous. I think if there was a big enough disaster, most people would be taking care of their own stuff. I'm not saying you won't get any help, but
The after action report from Munson and the tornado was just overwhelming. What happened, Kip, all the responders that should have been focusing on the event were handling
their own
the rubberneckers and all the people that volunteered, and the truckloads of stuff that nobody could use. It was just unbelievable.
Mm-hmm.
And that was only one case that happened in several of the communities.
It happens at every major disaster.
Well, but it does happen in every, and it is documented in all the FEMA kind of things.
Yeah.
And
You just don't have a police officer, they take it over to the state highway garage. Just take it over to the state highway garage.
If it's still there.
Right. Well, anyway, yeah. It is
well, the
a huge.
Lot will be there. Yeah.
It yeah. is a huge. Yeah. So the management of the spontaneous volunteers and the social media, I would want that to right. be part of the
now
job
you've talked,
description.
You've talked previously to me about wanting this yeah. person to take on responsibilities related mm-hmm. to the website and
yep.
social media and technology. And
yep.
Compliment
a part of it is from your, that workshop that Trevor and I went to, or. The
yeah.
emergency one and then the climate change one, and I think it is really important. So we can talk about that further. I don't know. We're not going to be able to spend time on the budgets tonight.
Oh, you have to.
Yep.
Oh, okay. I
we
mean,
won't
I'm,
spend that much time. I'm just going to
okay.
run through them.
Okay, go ahead.
Have you got what you've got are our budgets?
Yes.
Which are in the 100s, which is section 3 in your book.
Yep.
Should be up to date. I have more to give you, but we won't talk about those. I'll just distribute them at the end of the meeting.
Wendy,
so
what
if
I
you,
thought...
If you don't want to review them tonight, you can
well,
take them
no,
and review them.
We can go over them, mm-hmm. but what I thought is starting next week,
mm-hmm.
Maybe you could just post us as a meeting with the Finance Committee, not a joint meeting, but if we wanted to show up, to the finance.
That's what I've been begging for
yeah.
on your behalf.
Mm-hmm. We're going to just do it.
You are welcome to show up.
We're just going to do it, but okay. I would appreciate you just to post the next few.
All right.
And before we move on, I didn't see on the upcoming meetings, we have March 7th and 8th and the 22nd, but I didn't see the March 15th meeting listed,
right.
and we had already...
Yeah.
Set that aside yeah. as a joint capital improvement finance committee.
Right.
So could you
we
just
put that
add
in the
that?
Minutes and we'll get it scheduled.
Yeah.
So March 8th?
Well, March 7th is the budget meeting with the schools. And
that's
6
okay.
p.m.
Yep,
and 6 that's
PM.
And that that was at Frontier,
well,
wasn't it?
We're on 8th.
Yes.
Or
no, they're coming here.
Oh, okay. So they're agreeing to come here?
The 7th?
Yes.
Okay,
what
so
time was that?
7th is 6 o'clock. And
on
that's
their insistence.
And that's at Town Hall.
Mm-hmm.
And then the 8th is our regular scheduled selectmen's meeting at 6:30.
Mm-hmm.
And then March 15th is a joint meeting that with capital. And I mean, we're going to make some
what
decisions
time?
That night. And I'm assuming that because that's one of our meetings, that's a 6:30 meeting.
6:30, 15, 16. So we have every Wednesday. Except
right.
For the first.
Well, for the three, and one. Well, not the first, but it will be this. It will be the eighth.
Oops.
The eighth, the 15th, and the
22nd, the 29th.
And I'm gonna have her post the seventh, and the 21st.
Okay, 21st, same school budget.
No, just with the finance.
Okay.
Actually, we could do the 14th too, right? We should probably do the 14th, right, Wendy? Because was the Finance Committee going to meet the 14th?
I don't know.
They
seem to decide.
Every Tuesdays,
their every,
I
think they've been
even
meeting
though they
every
were
Tuesday.
Meet
they're
with
in.
Us on Wednesday?
Yeah, I think they're continuing. I don't know. They're getting through the budget pretty rapidly.
Okay, so then let's post us if should we decide to show up on
6
the,
o'clock?
On the, no,
on
that.
6:30? 21st? You said the 21st.
The 14th also, you said.
Yeah, the 14th.
The 14th is a regular Finance Committee meeting, and that is, they normally meet at 7, isn't that correct, Wendy?
I think you're
yeah.
right, yeah.
Yeah, so the 14th and the 21st.
At 7.
It would be 7. The only reason the 7th is at 6 o'clock instead of 7 is because the schools want it at 6.
Okay, so the 14th is the same thing. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So we have the 3 Tuesdays and the 3 Wednesdays. And that we should be able to get the budget done.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Well, I guess I'll just, rather than go through, please go through what you've got. And I'm giving out a bunch more now. Take one, and they're somewhat collated. These are hot off the press, though they've cooled from the beginning of the meeting. what wow. it is town office, building maintenance, highway department salaries, general highway expenses, wastewater treatment plant expenses, wastewater treatment plant salaries and police department expenses.
I think there's three.
Oh, each one?
Yeah, take one from each pile.
Okay, so you know what?
Okay,
I'll
handle
it.
Take that, give me one, you take those.
And we'll go like this, how's that?
This is police, there's two.
I was gonna talk a little bit at the beginning of each, but you wanna move on.
No, I just, because otherwise I'm gonna have a pile of.
I think what we can do, Wendy, is let's correlate them and look at them ourselves and then get back to comments with you.
I did wanna, okay.
Oh, another one?
Would you consider meeting earlier, just so we can go, let's see, when's your next meeting, is the?
March 7th.
Is it right here? That's it? Whoa.
We could meet earlier on March 7th.
Yeah, just to go over our budgets, what's under our purview.
Okay,
our salaries, our expense, our legal expenses, all of that, they're in there, look at our budgets, okay?
March 7th, John, we went ahead and appointed everybody.
Hey, John.
Is DDB while here?
Yes.
Do you have any update, did you wanna give us? Other than, I did tell everyone that the exciting news about the drill in October, and Kip and Trevor are supportive of us participating.
Good, yep.
If there's gonna be some kind of cost, once you get an idea of how involved this is, could you make sure that we have a little bit of budget for it? Because I don't want you to be penalized because of you being involved, okay?
Yeah, we'll work it out.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll figure it out.
All right. Yep. I wanna make sure that we cover it somehow.
Yep.
And we will, because I think it will be very valuable for us all to do it. I'll talk to the fire departments because there's going to be a swift water aspect, rescue and the tech rescue and all that kind of stuff. So I'll get the fire departments involved.
Yes.
And that would maybe save them some training money and stuff. And if there's anybody on the highway department or police department that wants any of these specialized training exposure, we make sure that they have the ability to do that, okay?
Sure.
But you'll have to give us some little budget, okay?
Yeah, we got to figure out what resources are needed, then we can do a cost workup.
Okay, all right.
Yeah, I don't know how many days we're going to look at, how many people they're going to really look for from Deerfield from a leadership perspective or operational.
We're going to make sure that this is going to focus around us.
Mm-hmm.
I already made that clear.
But
it's a multi-million dollar drill, so.
That's good. I hope they have some fine cheesecloth we can drag to catch all the mosquitoes and prepare for the invasion.
Well, actually, that's what happens. You know, that right after that, all that water creates mosquitoes. So, I mean, we've got problems.
So, Trevor, what do you need? Anything?
Signature.
Oh, okay.
How are you? I said I would give my report at the end of the meeting, which I'm just simply going to go.
So, Wendy, yes. You were talking about the 7th coming early on the 7th?
No, I guess that would be earlier than 6. So I'll just fit it in on the meeting on the 8th. I think in 15 minutes we can go through our budgets.
Catch them while you can.
That's all I want to do.
Okay. Can you guys go through the budgets and see if you have any questions you can get to Wendy?
And in particular,
yes.
The ones I want are the ones under our purview, which are general insurance, contracted services, which we're still working on, so that's
all right.
Put that aside.
Thanks.
Select board expense, select board staff, and legal. And we'll review those at the next meeting.
Okay.
Thank you, John.
In particular.
Thanks.
Good night.
See ya.
I just, since I haven't given a report, just kind of wanted to let you know. You're a very active board, and so a lot of you know what I've been up to.
Yep.
But I just started making a list and I stopped. I said, okay, I just stopped. Been very busy, been very here a lot. Sewer, I get a lot of questions from members of the sewer study committee, and I'm working on those questions having to do with votes taken at prior town meetings and then the abatement requests we've got and, you know, a lot of things. So, budget, Skip and Brenda have done a lot of work together. All the town department heads have been doing work. I've been involved to a limited degree, but more and more. compensation plan. I've been spending a lot of time on that, trying to bring all the information together. I want to thank Skip and the personnel board, and still working on it, but we think we're coming up with something good, and we'll go back to personnel board with that. I met last week, the FERCOG arranged for what we jokingly ended up calling speed dating. I came in, and they had every 15 minutes a different department come in and meet with me. It was actually very helpful. And one of the things I found out, and maybe you knew this from Doug, but because we listed complete streets on our on your community compact, we are able to access the portal, although I can't because they, their technology people cannot figure out how to make it work. But there were resources available, possibly sidewalk money, possibly other funds for the things so many people have been talking about over the last several weeks. So I'm working on trying to get into that portal to see what might be available to us. So that was good news to find that out. I also met with the Solid Waste District and got caught up on things. Next time we meet, I have a proposal from a book collector who sets up shop at transfer stations. And I've only gotten positive feedback. Kevin's all in favor. People can, he recycles books and we get some money from this. So it's a book collection program.
I have a few boxes.
Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. Well, that'd I'm sure collecting. You'll agree to go forward with this. So it's a moneymaker for the town. Not a whole lot, but.
When you talk with those people from Solid Waste, I've mentioned this several times, but what about the town taking over their own scrap metal program? Mm-hmm. Instead of paying $3,000 for them to bring us a metal dumpster when we could, you know, scrap the metal ourselves.
Mm-hmm. I'll ask about that. Yeah. I know when I was in Leverett, we were making a lot of money from it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is it RTE that you're still using? Or?
Yeah.
All right. Can you make a note for me? Thanks. I have so many things going here. Thanks.
Yeah.
Okay. excuse me. I did find out that Jan Amin, who's the director, I may lose my voice, has been approved to do inspections of closed landfills. And we know, and Kevin has asked Wes and Sampson in terms of monitoring, what part of that are they charging, you know, for that? And we, if it's considerably more expensive, we can, you know, as an alternative use Jan, who's now DEP certified to do that work. So
that's good. Plus,
so, you know,
with
I have to say that, you know, everybody's been great, but just, you know, and Kevin, anything like that, and the man has tremendous amount of things on his plate.
Yes, he does.
So bear with our wonderful department because they have a lot going on. Let's see. I was at the MMA annual meeting, mm-hmm. Just the trade show, but made a lot of connections, gathered a lot of information. There's been a lot of follow-up from them with the code people mm-hmm. and others, good. Lawyers. And speaking of that, we have an opinion from the two attorneys who consulted with the Division of Labor, and we have an opinion that we'll be happy with on the EMS issue with the wage issue.
Yep.
Annual town meeting, gearing up for that, getting out the fall town meeting that never happened, warrant to be fed up and start looking. And I sent out a potential schedule for opening the warrant, closing the warrant, and posting the warrant. So we can start thinking ahead. You appointed a committee to let's get going. And Kip and I will talk on Friday about the church. Select board meetings, I don't know. I'm here. mosquito control district grant, I've been quite involved with that as well, and I'm really excited that we'll be having two consultants who will pretty much take over what I've been trying to do and manage it, and I'll just be responsible for the grant part.
She's talking about Charlie Konecki, who was working for the state before, and also Greg Lewis from the FERCOG, and both of them are
top-notch.
Top-notch, and they work together, and their skill sets mesh perfectly.
And as everybody knows, we have a lot on our plate with our land use boards. I've been very involved. There's been many legal issues and other issues, training, et cetera. I've sent that all out to you, that we could actually bring in a trainer from the Citizen Planner Training Collaborative to do some of the targeted kind of training that we've been talking about. And we have one person from the ZBA, no, Planning Board, who stepped up who wants to go to their conference.
Right.
That's fantastic.
Talked about that. Snow days, we had a few. IT issues, I don't know. We're working with the budget on that. We're lucky to have John Futter has been helping us out in a pinch on a few things. I attended the Community Preservation Committee meeting. Great group of people, informed them about what we're thinking of submitting, which is got to be done right away. So they don't, they had a couple of other projects from the Historic Commission, but not much else. Okay. But they're aware that we would like the reserves to build up so we can undertake the housing project.
Mm-hmm.
Finished off with the contract last week, Old Albany Road Cemetery project. Yep. And we signed the contract with the, he's already done some work, and we'll continue when the weather gets better on that. I went to a library staff meeting. I've met with the senior center director actually several times. I want to meet all the town employees, and so I've asked Kevin, I actually asked Mike, when would be a good time to come by? And I'm not going to just pop in on them, but he said 2:30. Yeah. So I'm going to at some point get over there at 2:30 and meet all the folks there. Here's something. You know that the public records law changed. Well, it didn't really change dramatically, but the news about it changed so dramatically mm-hmm. that we are getting inundated. I've spent considerable time dealing with public records requests. Strange things.
Mm-hmm.
Not your usual, can I just have the minutes from that meeting? Just large kinds of requests. And
really?
It's a burden.
Yes.
It is a burden, and I consider it a mandate. So, regular communications with, I don't know what I was going to write there, I guess everybody. Tobacco regs, we've got that up and going since I've been
Thank God.
Here.
Yes.
I've both called and emailed New England Natural Bakers. I have not heard from them. So, mm-hmm. And I do not know about the legislation, but I, you know, don't know what to do next about that.
Okay.
And I talked
to you have no timeline on the legislation?
No. I'm not that worried about that.
Okay.
I'm more worried about,
mm-hmm.
concerned
no
about
combat.
What's going to happen.
Well.
Right.
And also I've been inundated with surveys, and I said to the COG, no more for 5 months or 2 months, whatever. I must have gotten 7 surveys in the last, I've been here formally a month.
Yeah.
Major things, salary surveys from the MMA, from the COG, then the DLTA mm-hmm. stuff, which I brought to you. Opinions about our federal money, both Community Action and FERCOG got together and said, let's ask all our communities. And these are legitimate. Mm-hmm. I think they're good. We were just bombarded with this stuff. And that all takes time. Thank you, Radar. So, any rate, there'll be more. There'll be more.
Can we just put on the agenda for the next time that we want to appoint the 350th committee,
mm-hmm.
just because it is coming up.
It's 6 years.
6 years.
Yeah.
I mean, so it's reasonable to start putting a committee together. And we have that one person you said that was really interested. We want to make sure that person, we contact that person and they don't think that we're not pursuing that.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
We did get a request from Conway. I'm going to just,
yep.
another request. I've put the ad in per your direction. To be in their parade.
Great.
I was going to bring that to your next meeting, or unless you would rather I circulate that with.
How do they want us to be in their parade? Just
that's up to us, I suppose. They're doing very, very creative things there in Conway.
Okay.
A lot of,
then we need to have a creative
poets
response.
And players there.
Yes,
so
let's
maybe
figure
could,
out
maybe
something.
Maybe we could make a float.
Yeah.
And we could ride on the float.
That'd be great.
I know we have a lot of classic car enthusiasts in this town. So.
Yep.
I just
only
can
if you can use this float in 6 years. I mean, you
What's
want
your
put your efforts
in
into your own float, right?
What's wrong with us?
Well, I'm good.
No, I'll have my wife drive up. I'll have my wife dress up as a scarecrow, and she can drive the tractor. And we can make a float.
Catching this?
All right. All right. And we move
We're
on.
All tired.
Oh, I'm
getting more.
No, that'd be fun. We'd love to.
Can I
love to get involved with that.
This packet that I had in my folder, is that exactly what you?
These are up. No, I've given you updates. So
there's some are duplicates and some.
Yes.
Are
yeah,
duplicates.
We have. You have
no,
to go.
what you probably have in your binder, there may, this
there
is,
should
no,
be a
this
date
is hot
on
off the press
yeah,
stuff.
Right down the bottom.
So right here. These are, see, there's
they
a date.
In,
there's
a,
okay. Yeah.
So you make sure that you replace it with
okay,
the date.
The newest
yeah,
one.
Newest
all right,
one.
Great.
And the.
But are there some in here that aren't here?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, all of those, I
yes,
think.
Okay.
I believe all those. That's, those are the hot off the press.
What, when yes, someone adjusts one,
yep,
everybody gets a new one.
All right.
That's why you got to pay attention to the date at the bottom, because
well, you
otherwise
got,
you go mental, because if you don't keep it up. This is, I mean, what happens is the next 2 or 3 weeks, you're shifting papers. And so you have to keep your book up to date, because otherwise you get... really
this is a limit there, and this is how do you went up almost $2 million? That's $1.5 million.
Well, you can go up 2.5% a year. And then you have new growth on top of that as well.
Which isn't plugged in there yet.
Yeah. I don't really have anything else. I mean, I was kind of excited about that drill, obviously, but
I am
really?
Too.
I didn't notice.
Hey, this is a multi-million dollar drill that is going to be focused
really,
around us.
If FEMA
if
still exists, it will be, it's really quite a sort of a disaster crown in, for Deerfield to
it
be
is,
the site
it
of
is,
this
and it's wonderful that
Northeast
can,
regional exercise, right? It's a
yes,
region one.
It's
yeah,
a major one that doesn't so, rotate in our
October
area for like a decade again.
Wow.
And for
yeah,
us to be focused,
I'll have to put some blue
help,
lights and red lights on my gator so I can go rescue people.
That's right.
But every single plane of ours can be exercised,
right, it, yeah,
and it's minimal expense to us, and we get to participate,
it
and
is,
we get,
I get the,
we get
the, knowledge
the structure
exactly,
of
yeah,
the Homeland Security, and actually you guys get to get up to date like really fast.
Do
I
want
get
my
best
with the badge?
I was just going to
yeah,
say.
Yeah, well, I you know I got one in the car, and
all
it
right,
took me a couple years to get one. So you
no,
guys are going to get
that's
one right
news,
off.
That'll be fun. It'd be good to get all that education.
No, it really is.
Yeah,
it is.
Good.
And then you won't panic because you'll have your own books of
right,
what you're supposed to do when we have something happen. And
well,
it,
maybe I can get extra badges if I bring a Trump banner.
Oh, no.
Hey,
they're
listen,
sign you right up.
We're doing this. We're doing this drill before the money
we'll
goes
see
to the wall.
We'll see how you feel in October.
Yeah, really.
What's in October? Oh.
Many months from now.
Yeah.
So
right,
exactly,
this has been a tough month already.
I'm not going to be here tomorrow. Are you proud of me?
Yes. You're not going to be here.
No.
I am proud of you because
every
you...
day for 9 days or something. So. I'm not going to be here tomorrow.
Good.
Neither is Pat. So the office is closed, and everybody has been told, and you know, we apologize if there's any inconvenience to the public,
Wendy,
and we'll take care of you somehow.
Pat, I'm really impressed that you came back from your vacation for us
nice?
Tonight.
Mm-hmm.
That's really nice. I want
very
you to know
nice.
I appreciate it. And Wendy, thank
you're
you for
welcome.
Working Saturday, Sunday, and Monday of the holiday weekend.
And I had visitors too that came in and helped with
I know.
A few things.
There was a lot of work done, and I appreciate it.
Yep.
So I'm glad you're taking tomorrow off. And anyway,
busy.
Okay.
Yeah, we're good.
All right.
To adjourn.
I was going to say, if you don't do it, I will do it. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you.